our next speaker is also part of the TIP program, Raj Brahman. We'll talk to us about low cost transportation, because I have a higher than the BMI on that.
Thank you, Mike. Good afternoon. And I'm going to talk about something different, where we can get low-cost graphite, especially from recycled tires for lithium-ion batteries. And Amit Naskar is the original inventor of this technology, and we demonstrated it uses graphite anodes for lithium-ion batteries, and we are working with David Wood for demonstrating in a large battery. So the licensing agreement, and you can contact Alex Detrana, and he's right there. And so we can give details. So we'll see what we have. For example, this is a great commercial opportunity. I have worked here 20 years. I have worked on different technology. This is something really we are very close to commercial. So what we are doing is we have millions of tires. So the worn rubber tires are mainly they sent to landfills in the past. And like 10 years ago, 2003, here we produce like 290 million of scrap tires, out of which 80% of them waste tires were used as applications in fuel applications or additives in civil engineering applications or in plastics, rubbers, and agriculture and various other things. Okay, that's what they did. Typically what they do is you take these tires and you can cryogenically pulverize into micron-sized particles, you can grind them into powders, and you can add as additives for plastics, for low-cost products. So what we have developed is, we have come up with a synthesis methodology to remove carbon black composites back from the tires so that you can use them as graphite anodes for lithium-ion batteries. And we have already demonstrated its use as anodes for lithium-ion batteries in the form of small kind cells. These are typical lithium-ion battery. What we want to do is we want to go from the kind cells to pouch cells, large battery. That's something we want to do within the this year. So that's a plan. So let's see the commercial opportunity. Either you can be either low-cost graphite anode material supplier to battery companies, or you can be the lithium-ion battery manufacturer. If you have, so these both are opportunities are available for you. So let's look at the technology description. So the way what we do is, so normally you take the recycled tires. Like I said, you can shred it and you can pulverize it. And what I call is we want a control sample. So typically you just take the thing, shred it, pyrolysis, and you recover carbon black. For vulcanized tires, people add 40% of carbon black into the tire. So we are recovering back this carbon black composites back from the recycled tires, and you can use it for batteries. And we are right now in three, and we have already filed the patent. And what we do is we do simple acid treatment. So what you need is you just pulverize the powders, and you need an acid bath. You can just preferentially etch and remove this carbon black as composite, do the pyrolysis. That's what you need as a furnace to pyrolyze and recover the powder and do it. That's what the technology. So the technology readiness level, we are at 3 and we want to be at 6 so that we can really demonstrate a large scale-up process, and also we can make a large battery. Once we demonstrate this, and it will be a real valuable commodity based on recycled tires. So let's look at the technology opportunity. So I want to compare properties of two different kinds of carbon we achieved from tires. So one is a simple pyrolyzed control carbon, and the other one is the acid treated and pyrolyzed carbon. So let's look at the microstructure. So if you look at the selected area diffraction, it's like circle. It's mostly amorphous, it's round. And it's a fluffy carbon and irregular shape. It's like 8 to 13 nanometer pore size. The surface area is like 96 meter square per gram. And it's completely amorphous. But if you look at the sample 2, we have this one-dimensional nanostructure, 3 to 4 nanometer pore size, and it's 64 meter square. It's a hard monolith. And if you look at the diffraction, we have both amorphous and crystalline. So we have something tailored microstructure of this carbon powder. So even though we are starting from recycled tires, we are getting something improved graphite with a microstructure. So the end product is a carbon black containing product comprising glassy carbon matrix with the carbon blacks dispersed in them. So what we did, we took both of these samples and we tested them as batteries. So typically in a lithium ion battery, you have two solid electrodes, anode and cathode, with the liquid electrolyte. Anode people use graphite. So here we are trying to replace graphite with this graphite from the low-cost source. So let's look at the technology leadership. So this is the cell we made carbon from this source. This is a standard lithium electrolyte, PF6, EC-DMC. Lithium as a half cell, this is a coin cell. When I talk about 1C, one charge discharge in an hour. So if you are cycling, charging and discharge, if you complete the cycle, that's 1C. So if you look at the properties, this is a capacitance. Capacity like with different cycles. So initially you have a real charge discharge capacity, you have a hysteresis. So that's why the Coulombic efficiency is low and it's get better, but with cycling it came down. This is the standard, like if you pyrolyze the carbon powders right now and you will get this. At 0.1C rate we did it. And also if you look at the first and second charge discharge cycle, first capacity was 800, second was like 500. It came down, then it came down to almost 200. So this is the control sample. This is not the sample we are interested in. And the rate performance, for example, you can do it at different C. At 5C, it's almost zero. 5C means if you want to charge your cell phone in 12 minutes and complete charge and discharge, and it's almost zero. You couldn't really do it using the sample. And the control sample capacity was 200 milliamp hour per gram after 45 cycles. So let's look at the sample, what we did with this acid-treated carbon composites. So here, with the same similar kind, instead of simple pyrolysis, with the acid-treated, and we got almost 400 milliamps, and we ran for 100 cycles, and the Coulombic efficiency was almost 100%. It was perfect. It's just like you take one of the commercial lithium-ion battery. If you test it, you will get something similar to this. And if you look at the first and second charge discharge curve, 500 to 350 was almost 390. And the rate performance, even at 10C, you can do 5C is 150 milliamp hour per gram. So before we could even operate at high C, fast charge discharge rates, here we could do that. So it's like a day and night difference, simple treatment, and we have the method. And here we have achieved like 400 milliamp hour per gram capacity after 100 cycle. And typically for commercial standard graphite, you get 360 milliamp hour per gram. So we have actually either comparable or better that's known from a standard graphite. That's what we have. So we have demonstrated a pathway for making high performance carbon material from the waste tire products. So it's, we are talking about waste tire products. It can be from even own tires, or if any pieces that's coming out from the tire manufacturer. So we can use any kind of carbon source wherever we have the carbon black. So, and you can use it for potential use in energy storage applications. So we demonstrated like lithium ion batteries, and you can use for sodium ion batteries or capacitors. I'll give more examples in the next one. So let's look at our competitive differentiation. There are so many different kinds of carbon available in the market. Like people talk about mesoporous carbon from polymer source. Some of them may have higher capacity than this one. Maybe it's okay. But with respect to cost, rate capability, long cycle life, scalability, our technology will stand out from rest of the products. And the other thing we need to find out is this ORNR technology, in addition to cost and performance, societal, economical. Because you don't want to pile up all these recycled tires on one area, because we have several millions of there. We have great environmental benefits of saving this recycled tires, and we have unlimited source. So you can just go to the source, you can build small factories where you can just recycle these tires, pulverize it, acid treat, and get this thing, and you can do low capital costs and green energy. So we are converting waste energy to energy storage. So if you go to Knoxville Utility, Tennessee Waste Services, they are collecting tires from everywhere, from the auto shops. So you can go there and start doing this right away. So you don't have to wait for that. And let's look at the estimated battery cost analysis market opportunity. So if you want to make like 100 amp hour cell, typically Argonne National Lab, they'll come up with this high energy cell. Cathode is the most, but graphite is like 11 to 15% because you have all this as part of the coin cells. Right now the cost of the material is $436 per kilowatt hour. Imagine when you have Nissan Leaf or Chevy Volt, 16 kilowatt hour or 24 kilowatt hour, you will be paying $16,000, $24,000 just for the battery. That's why Tesla cars are more expensive. So if you can reduce it, and the anode contribution is 11 to 15%, $48 to $65. So if you can reduce the price of the anode performance, you can use it in any of the, including the Tesla cars. And if you look at the one of this Duke University thesis report, so if you really want to have the market penetration, you want to have cheaper batteries. So you want to reduce the cost. I'm not saying you can go day and night, but you can at least reduce the cost by 10% using this anode contribution. You can really make it happen. So you need to bring it down to $200 so that you can have it for either hybrid electric vehicles or EV, any of those places. So the global battery market is $71 billion in 2008, and it's growing 5% per year. Global battery market is $21 billion, and $22 billion, it's increasing the market share. And let's look at the market opportunity for graphite. Like as per the Roskill estimate in 2012, like for 2016, demand is 32% of the carbon graphite will be used in the electrodes, refractories, and batteries, all these forms of carbon. And if you look at 80% of the graphites used in batteries are mostly consumed in lithium-ion batteries in 2012, last year. And the graphite consumption for 2016, we need like 114,000 tons of graphite. We really need 114,000 tons so that we can take care of the global market. Remember, we have a great opportunity to be the leader. We can have manufacturing and create jobs, and we have the technology. And let's take like typical Nissan Leaf right now. It has 40 kilograms of graphite it's in it. So you need a lot of graphite. So we have really good use of it. The graphite market is $12 billion. At least 10% of the market can be captured if we scale up this technology and what we have done to make it commercial. We haven't done it yet. During the last 3 years, the graphite demand, the prices have gone up. Like the graphite costs anywhere from $5 to $20 per kilogram. If you really need high quality graphite, you may have to pay $60 per kilogram. But as per estimate, it is possible to get dollar a kilogram using this process. It's possible because people are paying to get rid of their tires. They are paying to get rid of the tire. So once you get it, shred it, go through this acid treatment. We haven't done it yet in a large scale. If we do a real demonstration, and if you're early with us, and we can work together, and we can demonstrate some large battery quickly, and it can be a really big market because we have pretty soon so many Korean and other auto manufacturer, tire manufacturers are moving to Tennessee. So we have a great opportunity here. So let's look at the graphite production by tons. So we need like 3 million tons, estimate this is 2016. That's a whole graphite in the entire global continent. So you have different kinds of carbon synthetic, flake, amorphous, and vein. So all kinds of carbon material. So what is next? So what we want to do is we have a scale-up plan. We want to do this, scale-up this process to make large quantities of powders with tailored microstructure. And also we want to use our battery manufacturing facility. So this is something we have it at Oak Ridge. So we have this battery manufacturing facility at NTRC2. As part of the additive manufacturing. So we can use our facility, we can scale up and do a demonstration of this with your help, with the funding, small funding what we have from TIP. So we want to really demonstrate a large battery with the facilities what we have at Oak Ridge. That's what we want to do. So the commercialization plan, either you can be the material supplier, possible. We have not even talked to Goodyear and other tires yet. So I am sure they will be very much interested. So we are just, we'll be starting very soon. So they can be the GM, GE, all these guys could be the end users. Or you can also make this battery by yourself and build a manufacturer and supply the battery cells to them. So these are possibilities. And if you look at the plan, like in, if you start phase one, like 2 years, we feel like material supplier going through the pilot scale, large batches and licensing. So these two agreements, we can definitely help you to take it to the market. That's something we want to do in the next couple of years. And let's look at the applications and target customers and current practice. So like the batteries, graphite is not just batteries. They are used in fuel cells and supercapacitors. So all these applications, they need graphite. And lithium-ion batteries, here we are using it as the anode host material for intercalating and deintercalating lithium. And the primary synthetic, and they are using flake right now. Primary alkaline battery, you can use as cathode additives. Lead acid batteries, even in lead acid batteries, you can use as additives. Or fuel cells, you can use for bipolar plates or main filler materials. And the applications, again, we can use for any of the automobile applications or mobile devices or stationary storage or medical devices or even military applications. We can use it. One thing here we talked about mostly rubber tires. We can also possibly use from some of the plastic materials, something suitable where we can recover this carbon black. It's possible. So we can extend this technology. So I'll be happy to answer any questions. Thank you. Yes? These are, I think, more like, see, these are like a mesoporous. Pore size is 9 to 12 millimeter, but the particle size will be like a few microns, something like that. Yes?
So you have this acid washdown that you say removes the metal and also imparts this microcrystallinity. Do you have an idea of which of those two factors is, or how relevant each of those is?
Because you can remove the lot of the metals before even coming to that stage. Like you can use all these metal separation process, you can do those. But final treatment after acid treatment, we checked, we did ICP, and we didn't find any metals at all. Completely we removed. Magnetic particles, you can use it easily, some of them. But here, it's not just for removing metals, but we want to preferentially remove the sp3 carbon to change it to sp2 carbon, so we are making a composite. Yes. Yeah.
So you are removing one one recycled product, the tires, that are just a big problem. Are there any other waste products that come from this process? What are the waste and issues with storage there?
The issues are like sulfur is an issue, something. There are some sulfur maybe. Another thing, burning these tires, there are people still, there are environmental issues. But you can use like rubbers, the scrubs and other things possible, you can reduce those. So there are some challenges involved in this. Burning tires, yes.
You mentioned the acid bat. Can you disclose what type of acid it is?
We have already filed that thing. So if you sign the NDA, we can disclose exactly all the conditions. Do that, yes. Yeah.
You mentioned your particle sizes are 9 to 12
nanometers thick. That's a surface area.
Surface area.
Yeah. Okay. So this one is pore size is 8 to 13. That's the standard. But this is the one we need to worry about. 3 to 4 nanometer. We had like hard carbon monolith structures. So this surface area was 64 meters square per gram. So it may not be micron. It may be, sorry, it may be 100 nanometer possible. I don't know the exact size. Yeah.
Yes. So is that morphology control?
This is something we have done it, and we have repeated it, and we can achieve it, but we have not optimized it yet. That's something we need to do, yes.
Okay.